Building a gaming PC can be a bit daunting when you're completely new to the subject. So here's a quick primer explaining the most important parts and concepts. Since this video is aimed at beginners, I simplify and generalize a lot to keep things light and understandable. But I'm sure people will point out everything I glossed over in the comments anyway. This is Pixel Prophecies: Understanding PC Components. An average gaming desktop computer system usually is made up of these components. A CPU, the central processing unit, the brains of a computer. RAM, random access memory, for the CPU to quickly store and access data. A cooler, to cool the CPU. A GPU, a graphics processing unit that puts pixels on a screen. Storage drives, that are hard drives or solid-state drives to store data and files on. A motherboard, that's the hardware that connects all these components to each other and external devices such as keyboard and mouse. A power supply unit to provide electricity. A case to put everything into. Let's look at them in more detail. A CPU by itself is useless without power and memory. To hook it up to both, it needs to sit on a motherboard. The CPU connects to it through a socket. There's a variety of sockets depending on CPU manufacturer and chip generation. An Intel CPU won't fit on a socket made for an AMD CPU. Even an Intel CPU from last year probably won't fit on an Intel socket from 5 years ago. And even if it did, the motherboard's chipset would not support all the features that the new CPU has. The chipset is the brains of the motherboard. It's the combination of all the little chips that are soldered on. So a chipset is innate to a given motherboard model and manages how the individual components talk to each other. When you plug in a USB device, for example, it plugs into the motherboard, whose chipset allows the CPU to receive its input. There's a variety of motherboard models for any given CPU socket, supporting different features. For example, integrated audio, how many USB ports they offer, additional Wi-Fi functionality, or the number and maximum speed of expansion slots. Many motherboards also have this 2-digit 7-segment display that shows a code of what is currently going on. Very helpful when there's a problem and you don't even get a picture. Because CPUs are so fast these days, they require a lot of power and produce a lot of heat and need to be cooled. Heat spreaders and coolers are made of a heat conductive metal to draw the heat away from the chip. Fans suck cooler air in and blow it through the cooler and out on the back. The bigger the cooler or heat spreader, the better this works. To pick up the heat the most effectively, the cooler needs to connect as tightly as possible to the CPU. To help with that, there's thermal compound or heat paste. It's a sticky, heat-conducting paste that goes between the CPU and the cooler to ensure that there is no air between them. Then, a computer needs RAM, random access memory. RAM is the working memory of the computer, anything that's not stored permanently on a storage drive. Imagine the CPU as yourself and RAM as your desk. When you work on a project, you first fetch all the tools and resources you need from the basement, the hard drive, and place them on your desk, so that you can reach and manipulate all the things you need quickly. The bigger your desk is, and the easier it is for you to reach your tools, the better. That's how it also is with RAM. The bigger and faster, the better. RAM comes in the form of these bars, or DIMMs. As with the CPU, motherboards also have sockets that take these RAM DIMMs. Once again, different sockets support different types and generations of RAM. RAM comes either as a single DIMM or as a kit consisting of two or more that work in tandem. For example, 64 gigs of RAM can come as a single DIMM in a kit of two 32-gigabyte sized DIMMs or as a kit of four 16-gigabyte DIMMs. The difference is in speed and price. Current gaming motherboards usually have four slots for RAM DIMMs. And there's a clear order on how to slot them in for the CPU to access them the fastest. Further, RAM, just like CPUs, has specific features that need to be supported by the CPU and the motherboard. For example, there's RAM with ECC, built-in error correction, making it more robust, or XMP to store different overclocking settings. Again, a CPU needs to support these features. Next, there's the GPU, the graphics processing unit that makes pixels show up on a connected screen. That's what a graphics card is for. Without a GPU, there's no image. Many CPUs nowadays have integrated GPUs, meaning you don't need an external card. But if you want to play games at the highest quality settings, external GPUs are much more powerful than integrated graphics. To store data long-term, you also need storage. Magnetic hard drives like these are on their way out. Nowadays, it's all about SSD, solid-state drives that might look like this. These kinds of drives connect to the motherboard through cables. Newer storage drives come in the form of these NVMe bars that go directly into a motherboard and are much faster to access, but also more expensive. At this point, we still need to power the system with a power supply unit, a PSU. The most power-hungry components are the CPU and the graphics card. So the PSU needs to supply enough electricity for running both at maximum performance. And then some. To give you an idea, a current high-end processor needs up to 300 watt, a high-end GPU an additional 450 watt. About as much as a high-powered vacuum cleaner. Lastly, you want to put that high-priced jumble of electronics under your desk. And for that, it needs an enclosure, a case. Cases come in many sizes and with lots of different features. Compatibility there is also an important factor, as the motherboard and all the components need to fit inside. A case also needs to be connected to the motherboard so that the USB plugs on the front work and the power button can do its thing. Let's recap. A CPU sits on a motherboard that connects it to all other components, such as RAM, storage, and optionally a GPU. On top of the CPU goes the cooler. The motherboard is fixed in a case with a power supply unit supplying electricity. All components need to be compatible with each other, naturally. Usually, manufacturers have detailed databases on their websites to list which of their components are compatible with what others. And that's all you need to know to follow my failures in my upcoming video on my very own PC building odyssey. Until then, take care, friends. We'll be right back.